Good evening, Cape Elizabeth citizens, those at home, and those who have chosen to join us this evening for a joint school board, town council review budget. We're nearing the end of our process, and this evening we're going to feature a variety of items in the following order. First, we will review and finalize the community services budget. We will follow that with reviewing a school bus request from the Cape Elizabeth School Department. We will then finalize the school budget, the municipal budget, the sewer budget, and the Riverside Cemetery budget. At that particular point, I will invite any input from those in the audience. We will then close the audience input and review our update with regard to auditors for the town, as a selection committee has been working over the last couple of weeks looking at a variety of RFPs in this regard. And then lastly, we will adjourn as a finance committee to then reconvene as a town council. Having thus presented the order of the agenda, we will then begin with Ms. Susan Weatherby, our Director of Community Services, who will review for us this evening the Community Services Fiscal Year 1992 Budget Summary. Please.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, excuse me.
Surely.
I want to announce to the Finance Committee that I'm going to abstain from any discussion of Community Services budget because I have a conflict of interest.
Is that all? Do we have a consensus that that's okay with fellow councilors? Fine. Thank you very much, Councilor McLaughlin.
Community Services continues its effort to offer the type of programs desired by the citizens and supported by the town and school administrators. Our budget this year reflects careful attention given to cost-effective programming in a truly difficult budget year. Nonetheless, Community Services programs continue to grow, not only in numbers, but also in the number and variety of services which come under our umbrella. As we recap FY91, we saw substantial program growth in the following areas. Our extended school care program escalated to over 125 participants this year, necessitating an increase in staff as well as facilities. The program serviced 32 kindergarten children, 42 in our before school program, and 98 in the after school program. The budget revenues were estimated to be about $66,000, and we anticipate in excess of $95,000 year end. Our summer program has continued to expand, and this encompasses 3-year-olds through 10th grade students. The program has really realized enormous growth over the past couple of years, and last year serviced over 1,000 different children in the community. This program also exceeded our projected revenues by approximately $15,000. Due to the demographic trends, we have concentrated programming during the daytime over the past year, and we have increased our daytime offerings from 33 last year to 46 this year, with nearly 100% success rate in these programs. Our Senior Citizens Club continues to grow in numbers and the variety of programs offered. We've incorporated monthly luncheons at the school so that the senior citizens have the opportunity to be in the school setting, and this has helped to enhance the school lunch program revenues as well. Last month, Mr. McGovern came and spoke with the senior citizens and enjoyed lunch with them. We have many new programs coming up for the seniors this fall. We are going to offer our second overnight for the seniors. Last year we went to Montreal. This year we're planning to go to Newport, Rhode Island for 2 days and a night. And those numbers in that club now exceed 200 members. Resultant of the program growth and the unanticipated revenues in these aforementioned programs, I have predicted that we will end the year with a balance of about $35,000, which has been budgeted into next year's FY92 budget. As you review the budget, Please be aware of one very important point. The proposed budget does suggest nominal increases in many areas. However, projections and program revenues will in fact reduce community services requests for town subsidy. It's incredible to me that a program in a small community of only 8,000 residents can generate approximately $400,000 in revenues in support of its $500,000 program. Contained in the budget pages, I have given you a summary comparing individual program costs and expenditures, a detail of anticipated revenues for FY92, as well as a careful delineation of expenditures in each of the programs. In summary, as you consider the budget, please consider the powerful presence of community services in this town, not only with its own programs, but also their assistance in coordinating other town and school groups in their individual missions. Citizens are receiving nearly $500,000 of diverse programs and services for 15 cents on the net to tax, or a town contribution of $85,652. This figure of $85,000 represents a 6.8 decrease from FY91 into the FY92 budget. I look forward to your continued support of our programs, and thank you for consideration of this budget. I have also just highlighted the individual increases and decreases in all of the accounts. And if you'd like to turn to page 2 of your budget, we begin with administration. And I just thought that also accounted for in this budget is a 3-5% increase for community services employees, depending on whether they are part-time or full-time employees. So they range from 3-5%. In the administrative account, it says salaries increased by $5,000. That is not really an increase in salaries by $5,000. That is merely a transfer of percentage of time spent in administration. If you drop down to the adult ed account, you'll see where the administrative payroll is decreased $6,000. And that means last year when I tried to really delineate how much each program costs, I estimated the amount of time that each of the employees spent in each of the areas. And that's why there is some transfer from one program area to another. I found that we were spending more time in strictly administration, and I really couldn't credit that time to the adult education portion of the program. So there are some of those transfers, and that's why there's an increase of about $5,000. I can go down the page, Wayne, or you may, and I'll be happy to entertain any questions you may have.
So that might be a reasonable idea with respect to just summarizing the particular bullets that you've indicated here are the high points of any changes. I really don't anticipate a need to go over pages 4 through 17 unless there are specific questions, of which we'll be happy to discuss in detail. But just perhaps as a summary, if we could go through page 1 and 2.
Sure. All right, I've already mentioned the salaries and the increase of $5,000, and that was a 5% increase of the director's time and 10% increase of the assistant director's time. And that's just with office proficiency and so forth in terms of administration. The telephone is up about $900, and that's because we had an additional line added to community services. So we now have two incoming lines rather than the one that we have had in the past. In the past, our line was constantly busy, so now folks have an opportunity to ring into two lines.
Well, let me just say and interrupt for a second. So if any of us have particular concerns or questions, why don't we address them at the end of each bullet rather than saving them for the end?
I have left $3,000 of undesignated funds in the administrative account. And that's available for the expansion of daytime programming, perhaps for middle school students in allied arts or home economics, things that we might offer after the school day, things that they may have cut out of the budget because they've cut back a certain portion of time in that area. So we have put some undesignated funds into the administrative account for that. And that's administration. If there are any questions, I'll go on to...
Yep, if you're not interrupted, just go full steam ahead.
Under adult education, the administrative payroll was decreased by $6,200, and that was because the percentage of time was added to the administrative account. Instructor payroll was increased about $5,000, and that was due to expanded offerings, which should be offset by anticipated revenues. Printing increased by $1,000. And that's because of the increase in printing costs and also circulation numbers. We have developed an extensive non-resident mailing list, and this necessitates having 4,500 brochures printed each time we do our distribution rather than the around 4,000 that we have been doing in previous years. Postage is up, and that's due to the increase in the postal rates. The aquatics account is actually decreased. Yes, Charlie?
On the printing increase, mm-hmm. What percentage of response from out of our fair district, out of town involvement in our program?
About 10% of our total registrations are from non-residents.
So what additional costs added to non-resident program?
They pay $5 per course. In addition to what the non-residents pay. And then we have discounts for senior citizens, school department, and town employees. Okay. And those would be the exception to the regular fees. Aquatics, we've actually decreased the aquatics account by $2,100, and that's because we have been able to reorganize some of the staff assignments. Summer program, the administrative payroll was decreased by $2,500, and that was just some redistribution of director's time. The staff payroll has been increased by $16,000, and that really is realistic because that's about what we spent over budget last year. But our revenues were up even more than that, so actually the revenues will surely offset the increase in the summer staff payroll. In the other programs, and other programs refers to things such as the recreational Saturday programs, the youth ski programs, the after school adventure programs, the men's open gyms, all of those come under the other program categories. Administrative payroll was increased by $5,300, and once again, that's redistribution of time. Staff payroll was increased by $3,600, and that reflects the growth in the numbers of youth participating in our recreational programs on Saturdays. And the extended day payroll is increased by $3,600, and that's the growth in the program, increase of administrative time. And with the extended day program growing from 85 enrollees last year to about 125 to 130 this year, and some of the redesign of the program, I have been spending more time with the extended day program as in previous years, and that's why there's an increase there. The staff payroll is up $10,000, and that's because we have now have 14 staff people in the extended day program. We have to maintain a ratio of 1 to 10. We're now licensed by the State Department, and that is their mandate. So we actually employ 14 people on staff there. And the supplies are increased because of the numbers of children enrolled in the program. And those basically are the changes from FY91's budget into FY92.
Thank you, Sue. Please, Rosemary.
I have questions that fall under three categories, so I waited until the answer. And one of the items that I didn't see here was how do you go about reimbursing the school department, or how does the school department charge you for transportation costs for the ski trips, capability camp, after school, and preschool for kindergarten, shuttling, and things of that nature?
There's transportation built into the cost of every single one of those programs. In the ski program, it comes under contractual agreement, okay, and we do pay at the rate of $1.50 per mile for transportation, and we do reimburse the transportation account.
Okay. Is that, does that appear anywhere here? Does that show anywhere here?
What we do with Rosemary is a direct entry to the 9020 general account in transportation to offset the salaries that are spent in her program. So it's like when we do the payroll, the people are paid out of our account, she reimburses that account.
So does that cover the actual cost?
Yes, it does.
Thank you.
Did you say you had three questions?
Well, it was one question on three categories.
Oh.
On the after school, the ski trips, and the childcare.
Were there other, please, Carl?
I just have one quick question. It's probably along the similar lines. There was the cost, especially when you mentioned the extended daycares increase. So, are the light, heat, utilities, etc., are they direct billed also, D, from the same account, or there's
you
no
don't pay for utilities of
there's
buildings.
No accounting for
there is
actual
not.
Energy. Okay.
The only time that we do give money back is for school rentals, and all of the rentals that are collected from the different agencies that rent the buildings goes back into the general school fund. We facilitate it, we collect it, but we do not keep it. Okay. It goes right back into the general fund.
No, because that just, you know, it just, when you show a profit, it just shoot up a flag. So I just want to check, you know, how you can justify a profit if there's no cost for operations. Thank you.
Are there other questions or clarifications from any members of the school board or town council at this time with regard to the community services proposed budget?
I have one comment, Wayne, on the handout where it shows an arithmetical error. It should be on the net to taxes, should be about 6.4%. And at the same time, I would point out that on the school net to taxes, it should be 5.0%. Now, there are some other differences of 0.1%, I see, particularly in the tax rates, which may be a rounding problem. But we did make an effort based on last time to get down to 5%, and
yes.
I believe we've done that. And I think these two should probably be double-checked and corrected.
Well, actually, I had spoken to the town manager earlier today about this very issue. My understanding was we had to present it as stated here because we were rounding down to the nearest penny. Does that basically account for Mr. Leslie's input?
I will recheck the numbers that Mr. Leslie's speaking of. What I was speaking to you, Finance Chairman Freeland, in terms of was the tax rate. Itself, and that bottom was rounded to the nearest penny. I'll recheck the numbers.
Well, certainly, Mike, if you look at the $336,772 and divide it by the previous year's expenditures, you get a 5.04% increase based on those numbers. So it would round out to 5% flat. I'll give you the sheet at the end of the meeting, and you can double-check me.
Okay, that's on the school net. Peter, did you have any, and the is it exactly 6.4 in terms of your calculator for the community services net to taxes?
Well, I think whoever did the calculation divided the 5,828 by the decrease, or the fiscal 92 figure rather than the fiscal 91 figure, which would be inconsistent with the other calculations that have been done. And I believe it's 6.4, but again, I'll hand this to Mike on the way out, and we can get that right. But I just didn't want us to appear to be contributing 5.3% when we made quite an effort to get to 5%.
You did make quite an effort, and we applaud you. And we're going to officially have that net to taxes at 5.0 to account for your recent cutting off of in excess of $21,000 in your account. Thank you, Peter. Were there other issues or clarifications, any input at all with respect to Ms. Weatherby's presentation here of the community services budget for fiscal year 1992?
I had one. I may have asked this question when you made your presentation at the school board meeting a couple of weeks ago. Have you started to look at the aging population in the community and in the country in general and looked at what kind of a impact it's going to make on the services that you're providing now and how you're going to be able to provide those services in perhaps the next 4 or 5 years?
We definitely have, John. There are going to be more seniors in the 1990s. There are going to be a younger senior citizen population, thus they'll be more active, and we're beginning to see signs of them being more active in our programs. As I said, we increased our daytime programs from about 33 to about 46 this year, and every single one of them, I think, reached maximum enrollment. I think with the acquisition of the Shore Road property, we're going to be able to, or we hope to use that during the daytime for our daytime programming. Right now, our space restraints really prohibit us from doing anything more than we're presently doing. We're already utilizing the town hall, occasionally the public safety building, the library, the Lions Clubhouse, the First Congregational Church in South Portland, and we can't do any more with the spaces that are available. But once that house is open for use, I really anticipate being able to offer more daytime programming. And you asked about the senior population. I think we need to do more with that population that don't have children in the schools yet, more preschool programming as well. And with that daytime space available, I hope to do more programming for that particular age group as well.
Sure. Thank you.
Rosemary.
Just a comment. Sue, on the Saturday morning meeting, I said that I would like you to know what a wonderful job people perceive and know community service to do. I'd like to say that publicly again. And I would also note that in your goals and objectives for community services, one of your stated goals is to increase the awareness of the community as to the value to their tax dollar that they receive through the community services offerings. And I do hope that you do stick to that, because one of the things that people don't know when they look at their tax rate is community services is included in the school portion of the tax. Thank you.
Other input? Is there anyone in the audience that would like to offer any input, clarifications, any at all? Thank you. Well, in summary fashion then, with respect to the proposed community services fiscal 1992 budget, we are looking at community services expenditures of $477,911, community services revenue of $392,259, for a community services net to tax rate of $85,652. This would be, in Councillor McLaughlin's parlance, 15 cents on the thousand. That's the way she likes to figure it, and it's worked well for us in the past. This, I might note, is 1 cent less than last year's fiscal 1991 budget. And overall, it is really a 6.2 roughly lessened expenditure, or I should say lessened tax rate, compared to last year, based on the balance of expenditures and revenues. So as usual, Sue, you've done a superb job in terms of coming in the direction that helps us all move to that number this year, which is 5% on the overall net to tax increase. Hearing any particular debate or discussion on the community services budget, any further comments? Then I will accept on behalf of the Finance Committee, Sue, your proposed budget, and again with great thankfulness in terms of the work that you've done over the past year and I'm sure will continue to do in the future. Thank you very much. At this point, we will move to item two, which is a school bus request from the Cape Elizabeth School Department. Who is going to present this new issue here?
Well, I'll start and then ask you to fill in some of the details. I think it was last December, we had the usual form from the State Department, which asked us to fill out a request for buses. We discussed that at a school board meeting and went through the procedure getting approval from the board. Actually, we put in for two buses. The state, however, only approved for reimbursement purposes one. Our needs were such that we decided to go for a bus that would have lift capacity. We have one school bus now with lift capacity, and for a variety of reasons, I felt we needed to make sure we had an alternative. This would be a bus, however, used and useful for other regular purposes. At the time, knowing that the budget situation was going to be really tight, we did recommend to the school board that we support the financing for this bus as a three-year note rather than putting it in the budget. Buses run somewhere between $46,000 and $50,000. As we were looking at the budget, we felt that we would not be able to afford putting in the whole figure, and discussed that with the board, and again, from at that level, got approval for that. We went through the procedure with the state. The state has approved that method of financing. You probably need to understand that it's a fairly common procedure for school districts. Obviously, it's arguable whether if you take a three-year note out, it's like any other kind of borrowing. You are adding to your ultimate cost, but you do lessen the impact of a necessary purchase in any one given year. So we have built our budget with that in mind, but obviously as we get down into the bottom line here, we have maintained in our budget the financing for that as a three-year note, and obviously we need your approval to do that. And if you'd like to have a rundown of the exact figures, there's a line in the budget that breaks it down as far as the impact for this year, and you can point that out too.
That's under the transportation account 9020 sub account, and we have budgeted line 4732. We put in $16,440 for principal payment and an approximate or a figure of $3699 for interest, based on 3 years at 7.5%. Spoke to the State Department today. I couldn't get a straight answer because the question came up as to what if the question came up is if the state would allow us to pay cash for the bus next year instead of financing a three-year period. I don't have an answer for you tonight because the Director of Transportation was not in today, nor his secretary. And what we do know is that the principal payment is reimbursable on a one-year-old cost the following year. The interest, however, is not.
So that the bottom line net of unanticipated cost to the school department on this particular bus would be what as a bottom line number?
What did you see for the principal times three? But see, the thing on the interest, Wayne, is a good question. When are we going to go out and borrow the money? Or when is the town going to go out and borrow the money? If the town could probably take care of the expenditure over a period of 6 to 9 months, then that line could drastically change and become quite a lesser number, especially the first year or so.
You figure about 7.5% interest?
Please.
So you actually have about $20,000 budgeted in this next fiscal year for the purchase of the school bus?
That's correct.
Is that right? And you're assuming that you're going to get 100% reimbursement on all the principal?
On the principal, correct. Next year, let's say we're still, we met today with one of the bus companies as far as the bid to nail down the specs and that. $46,000 looks like a better figure right now. We've been approved for 48 plus from the state. Take that 46 divided by the 3 years or whatever, and that's what we would be getting back. If we spend it this year, we get it back next year. Next year's funding 100%. However, like I said, the interest is not refundable or reimbursable. There's a line in the EFM 45 that we do report, and they just leave it out. But if we would, let's say, go out and borrow the money just in January, February, so that number could become maybe $1,500 for next year. I think when Connie mentioned, we did fill out this form November 16th or something. And at that time, we thought, well, there's no room in the budget for a $50,000 bus, the preliminary numbers we had. Therefore, at that time, we talked about we had run this by the state as far as getting the 3-year approval, and they said no problem.
Rosemary, please.
Yes. I have a question regarding our current inventory of buses.
Sure.
We have 13 buses right now with the addition of the 91 International. We have two buses, a 1977 and a 1976 International that went off March 1st.
Correct.
That means we're going to have how many buses available?
We're running 7 morning plus 1 mini, so we get 8. We've got 2 plus another small bus, a spare, so that makes a lot of fun.
Okay. We have 11 buses right now that are in good working order without this additional one?
Well, we have 2 or 3 other buses that are quite, they don't have the mileage on it because of the size of Cape Elizabeth. Our longest bus run is probably 7 miles or so.
And the next oldest is an 81.
Correct. So that's still like 11, 10 years old.
Okay.
The situation we're getting in is like, I've talked to Keith today as far as athletics and that, to Charlie, the director of transportation. Come spring sports, we will have to go out and lease buses from ABC company, whatever it may be. Well, some days we have like 3 or 4 activities. We only have 2 buses, regular size, to go out plus 1 small bus.
Okay. Well, the MSSPA is looking firmer and firmer on the reduction of 15% of games, so maybe that won't be as bad
so
as we think.
And that's going to help, and we're also looking at that as far as part of the negotiation package, as far as the stipend system.
Okay. Where do buses go when they don't pass inspection to carry school children?
Right now, they're in the yard. What we have tried to do is contact certain companies up there that will buy them at a premium, say $1,000, which is not much money. That's a premium for an old bus. What happens to that money? It comes in as a revenue from the sale of a bus reported to the state at the end of the year, and we lose the money. Whether you sell it for $500 or $1,000, it's deducted from your revenues the year after. If this person does not wish to purchase these two buses, he uses them for parts. The bodies, the engines on the buses are fair, they're decent. The bodies are just rusted out. The floorboard is gone. It would, cost tons of money to have it fixed. If he is not interested, then we will be placing an ad in the paper and they'll be up for bid.
I see.
That should happen in the next 2 to 3 weeks.
Okay.
They're off the insurance schedule, but we just want them off the premises.
Okay. And my last question on this bus is, when we met in that all-day Saturday session, I asked if you knew if there were better fuel economy in the newer buses than the older buses. Have you run across the answer to that question?
I don't think I could answer that right now. What we met, we had Eric at the town garage sitting on the last 2 bids, the last bid, and he kind of brought it home and analyzed it for us, because Eric does the super work for us. And he recommends a certain type of engine compared to another one based on the size of the bus. They met today, and I was late for the meeting. I had another appointment. But they did come to an agreement, I guess. And all we're waiting for now is the specs to be rewritten out so we can put on a purchase order and order. think they went halfway between the top and the line engine because of the size of the bus. This is only a 25-passenger bus with a lift. You don't need the real powerful engine. What you have to be concerned about, I guess, was the transmission. So they kind of wheeled the deal there as far as what they can get for the dollars. But, you know, we're getting top-of-the-line vehicle for that $46,000. And it's, I believe, a Thomas body-built vehicle, which is a lot easier for the mechanics to work on.
Okay. Please, Jane.
You're talking about purchasing a $46,000 vehicle. Is it my understanding that the interest over the next 3 years, if we took out a loan, would be in the ballpark of $10,000?
I wish we could address that. Maybe through the way the funds are rolling in. Like I said, depending on when the town does go out and borrow the money, we could, first year, incur very little cost as far as interest. Second and third year, correct, you'd probably be around the $3,000 bracket for the next 2 years after that.
I'm just wondering if it wouldn't make more sense to just pay up front and take the money out of your contingency, hoping that there'll be more revenues coming in from some other source.
True, but then here's probably the only recommendation I can make at this point. If the state were to say at this point, no, it's too late to do that, what I would probably recommend is that we hold off and borrow the money, call the state in January or February to see if they have any excess funds, like we bought a bus last year. If that's the case, then they might allow us to pay off the rest of that bus in next year's current budget with whatever monies we do have left. If not, then we just proceed with the loan.
Dee, I will ask one more. I haven't been convinced that there's a demonstrated need for this expenditure, and maybe because I missed a piece of correspondence or something.
Expenditure as far as what, a bus?
This 25-passenger lift bus.
All right. Presently, as of March 1st, actually, we have one lift bus in the district that is using. We had two. One of them did not pass the inspection. Therefore, the state police, through the inspection on the 1st of March, took that vehicle and another one off the road. We're down to one lift bus, which is quite dangerous. If something should happen to that one bus, being repairs or whatever might happen, we don't have a bus to pick up some of the kids that we do transport to school on a daily basis. The other piece to that 25-passenger bus with the lifts is that it'll accommodate two or three wheelchairs. So therefore, right now, if we send if we have a field trip that has one of the kids that is in a wheelchair or children that are in wheelchairs, we have to send two vehicles. One is a small lift bus plus a regular bus for the 22 kids in the class. With this 25-passenger bus and the lift, we'll have one bus for whatever students need the attention plus the class. So in the long run, it's going to be a savings to us. Instead of sending two drivers, two buses, we'll have one. As far as the need, we could go out and buy a smaller minibus for, I don't know, maybe $35,000, $36,000, but then you still have two buses in the road for one class as compared to one.
Connie?
I haven't been here long enough to really analyze the bus fleet. That takes a while. And also, you have to understand in more depth than I presently do the interrelationship between what we call a lift, that is the exact number of buses you need to empty out your schools or to bring kids there at one point. But I have at least enough understanding of this to realize that there are several things I think you need to understand. It is always difficult to crunch a $50,000 figure for a bus. I mean, nobody likes doing that. On the other hand, when communities start delaying beyond the recommended cycle of replacing their buses, they very quickly get into a point of crisis. Buses do wear out, and if you don't have a regular cycle of replacing them, and with the very real issues of handicap access and so on, if you don't do it in a fairly systematic, planned way, you can quickly find that you are behind the eight ball, and then at one point you may find that you need two buses, and that's $100,000. So that this was the choice made earlier this year to try to get through a tough budget year, meet the planned replace and take advantage of what the state would allow us to do and so on. Not the best of all possible worlds, but a reasonable compromise. So I do recommend that we, to both the board and to the council, that we go ahead with this plan.
Phyllis.
I'm not questioning whether or not there is a real need for replacing the bus. What I can agree with is how expensive this money is to borrow. I really would like you to try to find some other way of purchasing the bus, maybe through a split payment if the state would agree to it, or taking it out of this current budget somehow. An extra $10,500 could be spent much more constructively over a three-year period. I'm sure you'll agree to that with a budget crunch. So just having one note for this amount of money, I think, is not a good fiscal maneuver.
I think, as Connie stated, is that when we did put the budget together in November, this was kind of an interesting way to do it. Plus, it allows the state also, in one particular year, to buy more vehicles for all the schools. I think at some point the state's going to have to realize that for $5 million a year, you don't buy 150 buses anymore, you buy 100. Well, 10 years ago, $5 million just to buy quite a sizable fleet. I hear what you're saying, and I think the only way I feel I can answer that is, like I said a while ago, should the state in January or February have, there are some districts with budget crunches right now that might not be buying a bus even when they did get approval in November. If we keep that in mind, then probably in January or February, we probably can contact the state, and if they say, yeah, we will have some money left over, maybe we can. If the budget, the present budget has passed here, warrants, we could possibly pay for it and not borrow the money at all. And then that would then give us the full amount of money next year as far as a reimbursable cost. I mean, that's, Peter?
I think it's a very slender hope, don't you, that a district will put off buying a bus, which they essentially will get for free, simply on the grounds that they don't have the money this year, even though the state will pay for it next year? I mean, how likely is that going to happen?
It's an unknown. Like, it was an unknown 2 years. I
think it would take a pretty dim school board to make that kind of decision, because if they kept that policy in place, they would end up without any buses paid for by the state.
I understand.
So I wouldn't hold out much hope for that personally. I think the major point here is that we do not have a backup bus for our handicapped students in case this one that we have breaks down. Correct?
Correct.
What would we do if that bus broke down or were involved in an accident?
We'd probably have to contact another district and see if they would lease us a bus for a period of time.
It's 7 o'clock in the morning?
That's 7 o'clock in the morning. Or else we'd probably have to contact an agency that has a van or something that could transport that kid.
Do you have any backup for such an eventuality?
Well, at this time, no, I don't. Good point.
As far as the interest goes, I frankly think that considering the fairly low interest rates that now prevail, and I would suggest they might even be lower than 7.5 by the time we went out to borrow this money, that it is appropriate to stretch our purchases out over time. It's done constantly in the private sector through lease purchase agreements, and I think 3 years is a fairly short time. And I don't think we can go without this bus.
Can I just ask for clarification, Peter? Are you speaking on behalf of the school board as, I mean, is this a recommendation of the school board? It's come through Connie, and Dee are speaking on the issue, but I'm just wondering.
Well, this is a workshop, so I'm
right.
Essentially speaking my own mind. This has been approved in our budget
Okay. And
voted on unanimously by the school board.
Okay. So you're supporting the expenditure. The debate at this point is really the funding more than anything else.
Okay. We need the authority from you people to go out and fund the purchase.
Okay. Billy?
To follow up a little bit of what Council Amaral had to say earlier, and I'd like to ask you a question beforehand. Will they reimburse a bus if you paid for it in 1 year, or are they going to pay you back 3 years, a third at a time for 3 years? How do you get reimbursed on it?
By the approval. We applied for a bus in November for a three-year purchase.
But if you applied for it for 1 year purchase?
Then if you're granted that approval, then you get for it after 1 year.
You'll get your money back after
That's
1 year.
Correct.
So you are looking for this bus come September?
Come August, correct.
August, I mean, for the next school year. That's when you're, and you have to have the order in how soon?
Hopefully we can get the order in by next week.
In order to get the bus?
Yeah.
You can't prolong it a month and then expect to get the bus. Is this what you're telling me?
I doubt we'll get it by September now.
What we're hearing, Billy, is that if we put the order by next week, the chassis is the most important thing. After that, then we can get it in August. If we delay, then it's anybody's game. I don't know. I can't answer.
I didn't mean to delay it until August. I meant to delay it for
a month. No, delay for a month. No, I don't think you'd have it come September.
You wouldn't have it come September. You've got to do it right now.
Last time we bought one, I believe we had put out the purchase order like in March or April. We got the bus in October.
Okay.
Phyllis.
You are planning on paying for this bus over a three-year period. How many other buses are you going to be needing to purchase within, say, the next 2 years? And are those also going to be done in a three-year increment?
That, I guess, would depend on the way the budget formulation is compiled next year. If, like I say, it's bad timing on the state's part as far as asking us what we're expecting to buy for buses when we don't know what the state's going to give us for money. I would like, what the unique thing is, Phyllis, is that when you do get approval, and you get approval for a full purchase 1 year, is to take that money and roll it over and buy another bus and keep doing that. However, the state, in the last, well, the 4 years I've been here through the budget process, the state has approved one bus the first year I was here. Plus, last year we got lucky. They said no 2 years in a row, but then they had some excess money, and we had the money left in the budget. It was whether you carry it over or else but buy a bus, you get the reimbursement quite quick. They authorized us to buy a bus in March or April, which we did. I think what kind of, we were a little, I don't know, I was cautious about was that the state, if we were to go out, we asked for two buses this year. And we wrote a letter from with a signed note from the state police saying that he would come March 1st, take two buses off the road. And we did send that to the state. I think I was a little hesitant, I guess, because asking if we were to buy two buses and pay cash for two buses or even one bus, they'd say no. And that would be the end of it. Then we would have no bus purchase. At least by this way, we're going with both buses with the anticipation of paying for them over a three-year period, that the chance of them saying yes were probably greater. That's the reasoning I took on.
I have another question. Are you sure that they will reimburse us 100% on the principal?
Correct.
It's not going to be tied into our subsidy percentages at all?
Bus purchase is a separate line, the EFM, ED-269. It's a program cost, like special ed is, like early childhood, like other transportation costs. But the bus purchase is 100% reimbursable the year after. And it is spelled out right there. It's a good reimbursement.
So we'd be getting reimbursement from them like next year for this year?
Correct. Next year we get $16,000, whatever it is, a third of the bus, then that would be put
so
into
4 years before we really get completely reimbursed.
Dee, I have a question. One of the issues seems to be that this particular vehicle would be a backup vehicle, or that'd be the primary vehicle, and the little one we have now would be the backup, the one that has the wheelchair accessible entry point. If we did, for example, for a day or so, needed some kind of repair, could we use an ambulance in lieu of a bus, a wheelchair accessible ambulance? They're about $280 for a round trip, from a typical home back and forth to the main medical center. I know that is just a fee that I've heard before. On a given day,
yeah.
I mean, is that acceptable as a backup or?
Sure, it would be, but I think what we do is probably contact other schools in the surrounding area and try to deal with them for
to trade kind of.
I think the bus that we're buying now, the other bus that we're buying, will not be a backup for what we have now. It's just we feel that, you know, talking to Charlie, who runs transportation, is that he spends an awful lot of time sending two buses on field trips when there's no need to do that. And by doing this, then he'd free up the one driver. When you're paying these drivers, you know, $8.50 an hour, whatever it may be, plus you tie up two vehicles, plus it just becomes cumbersome for him to do a schedule. If you're going on a field trip to 10 miles away, you get two buses going there for 22 kids, it's just ridiculous. And I think that's the primary reason for him asking for a 25-passenger with the lift. His second choice was, I believe, a 72 or 76-passenger full-size bus. But his primary concern is to get that size bus so he can, his needs are greater, I guess, for that size bus.
If we had this bus, would that mean we could cut back in terms of drivers then? We didn't need to send the two buses?
No, it's just that we're adding on right now. It's an extra cost to us. Like, if the need would come where there's a field trip, let's say down to Portland, and you got to send two buses, let's say it's a 1-3 field trip type thing, then he's actually taking one of his, or two of his drivers that probably need to drive the afternoon runs and sending them into town. To me, or to him, it's just an added expense at this time. The small minibus we do use, because we do have places in Cape where we do pick up some kids that you cannot send a full-size bus to turn around and things of the sort. So it's not a filler. We do need another lift bus, don't get me wrong, but then this would be, I think, quite useful for short trips and things of the sort.
Billy, you had a question.
No, I was just following up here in my mind. I think I understood you to start. You got 12, 13 buses altogether, or 15?
We had 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
11. How many years do you expect to get out of a bus? Do you anticipate getting out of a bus?
The state gives us 150,000 miles or 10 years. Neither apply to us because we don't have long bus hauls. The buses that we did retire were 14, 15 years old. The engines are decent, I believe.
I understand all that. I'm just trying to figure out why there isn't a bus a year built into your budget.
Because the state won't approve it.
They won't approve it that way.
That's correct. We've tried that. And like I said, the ideal thing is to get one approval, and then you just let the money roll over. You buy one bus. So year one, you put up $50,000. Year two, they reimburse you that 50, so you buy another one for that 50. Year three, you buy another one because they reimburse you again. If you can do that, get in that rotation, you're fine. But if you can't, then you got problems. Because then you spike, you go up and down. Either you get one or you don't.
Well, this is a part of bothering me. Seems so it would be
a
good program to be on to have a bus a year if you're going to get 12, 14 years to get that many buses. So every 12 years, you...
The idea.
And I don't understand why the state don't understand that.
Because they have districts out there that have 60 buses.
Yeah, I understand that. Well, they can get so many buses out here too. So they should have it figured out that way. Buses.
It's a question of money, I think, down at the end of the road.
Well, it's a question of money everywhere.
I know it is.
Phyllis.
Yes.
Oh, excuse me.
Once a chairman, always a chairman, right,
Bill? That wasn't it. I thought he said Billy, but he said Phyllis.
Did you have something else you wanted to say?
No, right now.
I just, we're talking basically about you're taking a little over $29,000 more out of your contingency fund this year to be able to fully buy the bus out of the budget because you already have set aside almost $20,000. So I don't think we're really arguing so much that there is or is not a need for the bus. It's a matter of how it's funded.
True.
And I would really like to see you just take the money and buy it.
True, but what if, I'm just posing this question, what if the state tells us tomorrow that they don't have the funds to pay us back next year? That's the question.
Well, maybe you can explain a little bit. You have an approval now, the way we understand it. For a three-year payout on a bus.
Right.
In order to get the state to reimburse us for anything other than that, you have to resubmit a proposal.
Correct.
And have that approved.
Correct.
If we were to sit here tonight and say, we'll pay for the bus, we don't automatically get approval on that.
That's right.
Okay. So I want to just make that totally clear. I'm not sure that is at this point.
I tried to get that answer today, I just couldn't. That's just impossible.
Does that mean they won't reimburse you at all? If you go ahead and pay for it,
no. The worst case scenario is that they still reimburse us over 3 years.
Over 3 years.
Did you know how soon you could get that answer?
It's a good question, Connie. I guess the thing is, if even if he's there tomorrow, and if he says, no, I'm committed to the $5 million as approved by legislature, then what do I say? I think if the approval were made, I hear what you people are saying, you're getting it wrong, but if the approval were made, and I believe the only way to probably address this is probably in February or March, if they do have the excess bus money.
Janet.
In the course of discussion, some of my questions have been answered. I'm wondering if the school board has now, or has had in the past, will consider in the future, a policy in their budget of setting aside X amount of dollars on an annual basis for something like this. It would be something similar to what you do for maintenance. You may not spend it all in a given year, but you have it there to have a dedicated line or whatever for bus purchases, so we don't get caught in this kind of funding bind in the future. I understand you saying, well, maybe you can only get paid back over a three-year period. Okay, as long as you're gonna get paid back on the principal, that's fine. You're not getting paid back on the interest, and that's what my problem is listening to this, and I think that's what I'm hearing from some of the other counselors, is the problem with paying a good $10,000 of interest over 3 years when we are in such lean budget times. That's where I'm having trouble. Can you tell me how many students we will have in September who will need the handicap accessible buses?
I don't think we have an absolute answer to that. I would just want to point out that this is a kind of across the board problem in our buildings. And clearly transportation, as I'm sure you're well aware, is an issue that we certainly have obligations that have been heightened in the last few years. So the concern about having, even if we only had one student, for instance, who is in a wheelchair at the present time, we still have an obligation to make sure that we are, you know, up to speed. We also, of course, do make, I think it was also pointed out earlier tonight, the relationship we have with transportation, with community services, but we certainly have, I'm sure, at various times, trips, people who may be senior citizens, non-school friends, I don't know how much use you might be making in this bus, but I would certainly anticipate that that would be one of the wider community needs for this kind of thing. So, with a school system this size, you may only have one, two, or three youngsters in any given time who need that lift, but when they need it, of course, it's an obligation. And then I think we have that wider issue, what other use besides students or whatever you might kind of tie into that. So
I understand the obligation part. One of the arguments I've heard is that because so often there are field trips and we're sending two buses, if we have, you know, I'm wondering how many children we are accommodating on those field trips. Are they, you know, I think that's a valid question.
Yeah, that is. It could be one of the kids that basketball, something, sprained an ankle on crutches or whatever it may be, you know. There's a lot of scenarios I can't think of. As far as, you bring up a good point, as far as setting so much money aside on a yearly basis, like let's say $25,000. However, should you set aside $25,000 and you make application in November and you're going to buy a bus, let's say you're going to pay half this year and half next, the state says no. So the $25,000 is not, if you are to spend it, it's out of your pocket, not reimbursable.
But you have a contingency fund now. You can sit there. You can earn interest.
But the issue here, I think, is will the state authorize Cape Elizabeth to buy a bus and pay cash for it next year?
Right. I understand the year's current situation. I'm proposing this as a policy for the board to consider in next year's budget, and I hope it will be taken under consideration. I'm still uneasy about the $10,000 that I'm visualizing being paid in interest in 3 years.
Let me just clarify one thing. At this particular point, we're discussing this proposal, this request from the school board. At this workshop, we are not going to vote on this issue. We're going to adjourn. We're going to, you know, and then begin a council meeting. And this is going to be item 160. So 160 is to consider a report from the Finance Committee on the proposed bond for a school bus and take any necessary action. The discussion isn't necessarily going to end at the workshop level. We can certainly continue that discussion in the context of the town council meeting following this workshop, where there may be more questions generated. I'm more than happy to try to, you know, bring some kind of closure to the issue at the workshop level, but I just wanted to let remind people that we do have that other option. Please, Jane.
I just want to have one thing straight before we do the regular session. If we chose to pay for the school bus up front, the only danger, or the only downside from doing that would be that it might take 3 years before we reimburse to them.
Sure.
Did you have another
follow-up? I do have another.
Please.
I apologize to the school department, school board, because I wasn't aware of this coming up in the budget discussion. I wish I had known earlier in our discussions with the school board that there was this proposed funding mechanism. Is there anything else in your budget like this that you want to tell me about now? I feel like I've been surprised with this, and I'm wondering if there are any other things like this that you were planning to bond rather than, thank you.
Peter.
I was just going to assure you that it's the only issue of that particular nature. However, I can't assure you that there isn't something in here that, you know, isn't clear that you haven't seen, but I think that's the only issue of that, of that nature. But I want to assure you also that we do talk about buses a lot, and we have in the 3 years that I've been on the school board. It's a constantly moving target, principally because of the state. The state is changing its policies, and frankly, I think we've played the state school bus funding game quite well and taken advantage of opportunities that have come up. But like our physical plan, which has been somewhat neglected over many years without the type of sinking fund that you suggest, we have a similar situation with our buses, where we have constantly been playing catch-up and just barely making the grade. We need this bus one way or the other. I personally would be appalled if we took it out of our contingency fund and ran a contingency fund starting off with $46,000, taking that with more than cut it in half, or just about cut it in half. I think that would be a terrible mistake. We wouldn't have any margin for error for anything going wrong. I think I would I don't think we'd be complying with the law probably if we hired ambulances, but maybe we would. I think we probably have to look into that. But I only speak for myself. Maybe some of the other board members are willing to cut the contingency fund in half and simply buy the bus. But the bottom line for me, and perhaps this is the banker in me speaking, I don't think interest is a bad thing. Interest is a way to purchase physical assets and defer the cost over a period of time rather than coming up with it all today. It fits in our budget this year. It's a fairly small number. $10,000 is certainly a very small number when you consider we have a $9 million budget. I personally don't see, I think this is sound financial practice.
Mr. Manager.
Yeah, not to disagree with my good friend, the school board chairman, but the problem with putting out for notes items that you know you're going to be buying every year and you're going to be needing every year is eventually you end up, if you start down this road, you would eventually end up paying almost 50%, particularly for items over 10 years, you end up paying about 50% more than you would otherwise need to pay. If you look at just the situation with buses, if you started down the three-year track, right now it's 3,000. You have 11 buses. If you continue that, eventually it'd be $33,000 a year out of your budget that you'd always be paying for interest in order to replace buses based on this schedule. In the private sector, one of the reasons they do that a lot more is because of the tax code and depreciation schedules and that sort of thing. We don't have that in government. Perhaps we should, we don't. I think there is a fundamental difference, and I generally have not favored, on the municipal side at least, borrowing of items of a small quantitative value.
May I ask a follow-up?
Please.
Would you, if we were, for example, buying computers over a 36-month period, which would have an implied interest cost in the purchase price, in the monthly payments. Would you think that would be inappropriate for the school?
If you're doing what exactly?
Well, let's say you're buying on a lease purchase. You're buying computers or anything. Over 36 months.
The town has never buys things over a lease purchase because of the interest rates that are offered are way above what we can get on our own. If you check most of those lease purchase arrangements, they're generally charging you about 10% interest. Even if the town borrowed the money directly, you know, as the discussion has indicated tonight, we can do a lot better than that. So to answer your question, no, I would never do a lease purchase.
What if the interest rate were comparable?
I have never seen one that's comparable. And going back to the point is, if it's a one-time purchase of computers and that's not something you're going to be buying all the time, it might be advisable. But I think one of the problems that we've had here for years and years is that, and particularly on the school side, and I don't mean to be critical, but this goes way, way back, is that you need to have a five-year plan because there are so many of these types of things you need to be buying all the time. One year it's computers, the next year it might be window replacement, another year it might be textbooks. And, you know, obviously you don't want to start borrowing textbooks, but what you need to do is figure out how many total textbooks you have, what is the average replacement schedule, what is the average present value of books, how much should you be investing in textbooks each year, how much should you be investing in computers and so forth. And, you know, I think if you went about the budgeting that way, and if the town kept more on its schedule as it doesn't do as often as it would, in the long run the taxpayers would be better off and there'd be a lot more predictable spending and fewer problems.
Well, I couldn't agree with you more. We certainly should buy new classroom furniture every year, but in the budget process, that's the type of thing that's easily cut. Sorry, Billy.
Billy, please.
All right, no problem. I'm sitting here, get the feeling and understand that you need the bus. No question about it, you probably need the bus. And I should think, I don't understand the state, but a lot of people don't understand the state either. But why, if you got on a program, they wouldn't love it that way, and they'd know how much money they'd need each year if they knew how many buses was to be purchased. The only problem I have is the interest problem. And if there's other ways that we could purchase the bus, I would hope we'd go ahead and do it. And I know you don't like to tackle your contingency, but I'd gamble with it if I was sitting there.
Rosemary.
One last clarification, Dee. On the state demands, you put out of service buses after 10 years or 150,000 miles? Is that, they demand it?
No. That's the earliest you can put out a bus.
Oh, good.
But it's still based on need. I mean, everybody submits a request come by November, then they go by need.
Excuse me, I think your question is, do we have to retire the bus
right
at that time? Again, that depends on the condition. The real reason you have to take it off is when the state police tell you you have to take it off. That's what really does it. But that is a good rule of thumb.
Just what I would like to warn everyone about is looking at the inventory of buses. We have two that are 1981, two that are 1983, one that's a 1985, two that are 1986, two that are 1987, none that are 88, 89, none that are 90, one that's 92, one that's 91, and I imagine the next one will be 92. So we went through a period of 3 years where there were no buses purchased. So we are going to need.
And we still request at least one or two every year. I feel like Peter doesn't. I think we could work together on this, and maybe we don't need to go out and borrow the money until next June and fund it ourselves. And then the worst scenario is that we pay about $6,000 interest over the next 2 years. First year, we fund it. I mean, we pay for it. It comes in, we pay the bill. Then we go out in June, get the money through a two-year note at that time, and then we only have to do it.
Okay, is there any new information or new opinions other than the ones we've already heard on this issue. Billy?
We put the manager to work with his pencil again. The last time we took $25,000 out of the contingency, and when he got done with his pencil, he had $21,000 back for it. So I think we can move on to something else.
We can certainly do that and extol the manager to do more magic, but we will return to this issue this evening as item 160 in the context of the town council meeting. Let us proceed to item 3, finalizing the school budget, and I will ask the chairman of the school board perhaps to just give us the bottom line, since we've had extensive reviews of their budget and joint workshop previously. Peter.
Thank you, Wayne. The proposed expenditure for 91-92 is $9,203,774, which represents an increase in school expenditures of 3.6%, and the town portion of that, which will be funded by real estate taxes, will be $7,017,592, an increase of 5%. And that is the budget that we recommend to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Is there input, questions, clarifications? First, I'll invite the audience. Are there any questions with respect to the bottom line of the proposed fiscal year 1992 school budget? Seeing no questions or input, I'll return back to the workshop group here and ask for any other input. Seeing none, I feel confident in speaking for the council that we're in a position to accept the proposed school budget as just stated, and we will let me see here, and we will return to that as item 157 in the context of our council meeting this evening. Thank you, Peter. Let us proceed to finalize. And what I might do with respect to my councilor colleagues is I'd be very happy to group the municipal sewer and Riverside Cemetery budgets as a threesome and only ask if there's any input changes that anyone would like to propose rather than going through them singly. Seeing none, we will return to those three issues also in the context of our town council meeting following the conclusion of this group budget update workshop. Let us proceed to item 7 with respect to the update from the auditor selection committee. I guess that's me. Jim Murray is not here this evening, however, Debbie Pizzo is. Let me just briefly review where we are at with respect to the Auditor Selection Committee. As you know, the Town Council periodically reviews our use of town attorney and town engineer and town auditors, and we have in the past rotated the employment of various firms in order to conduct the town's business. Recently, the town council felt that we were in a position to advertise based on having retained the current accounting firm of Runyon, Kirstein, Willett, and Lessard over the last 3 years, that it was coming up at that particular rotation time to advertise for external audit proposals. We received a total of 7 proposals, and these were all reviewed in great detail by a subcommittee that included myself, Jim Murray, one of our town residents, and quite an expert, savvy businessman in this regard, in addition to our town clerk, Deborah Pizzo. We reviewed the proposals, and we narrowed down the 7 to 4 firms. We conducted interviews, and during these interviews, we really asked a wide range of questions, including the number of hours each firm would take, the total price of the audit, the hourly amounts charged beyond the audit, out-of-pocket expenses, the particular talents and training of the engagement staff for the audit, made sure that our deadline for a final audit would be acceptable and workable with whatever firm we chose to go with, the extent of training our town personnel would need to assist in the pre-work, and a host of questions regarding the specific proposals. In the letter of recommendation to the council, based on the four groups that we had interviewed, we really felt that the RKO group has provided a fine service to the town of Cape Elizabeth, and quite honestly, they were sort of neck and neck with the other firm of Berry and Falls. We felt that looking at all issues, RKO had a slight advantage to Berry in Falls because they knew our system, they knew the personnel, and to some extent we felt that this was a added feature in their behalf. But again, I want to underscore that, you know, it really was very, very close in terms of competency and our belief as to who could do the job the best with respect to RKO and Berry and Falls. We generally felt that there was a slight edge to RKO, only again because of the features that I've just mentioned. So that at this particular time, I think the issue for the council is the following. Do we want to make a change with our town auditor at this particular point based on our tendency in the past to rotate firms? If we do, our recommendation is to use the firm of Berry and Falls if we want to change firms. If we want to stay with the current firm that we are using, our feeling was that there might have been just a slight advantage to the particular RKO group that has done our auditing over the past 3 years. So that, Debbie, if you have any further input to that, that was my feeling of the committee of three. Can I ask for input from my fellow counselors at this time?
Wayne, I have a question at this point. The RKO proposal included a federal compliance single audit.
Yes.
For $1,500. What is that?
It's a requirement that if there's a figure of over $100,000 of use of, I believe, of federal funds, that audit must be done every year with respect to the firm that wants the audit done. Berry and Falls also would be doing that audit. They did not break out their particular price from their bottom line price for us, but that is included in their bottom line.
Thank you.
Please, Rosemary.
Yes, when the school board put together their budget, did they include all these costs that we now see in the proposals?
I'm not sure of your question.
I'm sorry, I'll restate it. I will restate it. The quote that was given to the town recently, was that information incorporated into the school budget, or did the school budget for the audit come up short on what RKO was projected for next year?
I think it's within the ballpark. Do you have...
I just looked at the numbers, first time I see them, and to me, a lot of these, Rosemary, are paid out of different accounts.
Okay.
The lunch program is responsible for the audit. The single audit, that would be responsible under the federal and state programs. The activity account.
I tried to add it up, and it didn't seem like your stated audit account was sufficient, and that's what...
You'd be looking at the school, the 20, whatever it is, the general account, plus possibly the activity account. Everything else would be out of the special and the lunch and whatever fund it is.
Okay, thank you.
Billy?
I'm in favor of going along with RKO, as far as I'm concerned. And I'd like to clear up one point with the people out there in Newsland that this isn't LP Murray, this is the real Jim Murray.
Jim Murray. Any other input? Michael, when is... we can certainly achieve a consensus this evening at the workshop level. Is there a proposal on the April council meeting for a vote?
Yeah, what I was hoping to do is have on the agenda the appointment of an auditor with one recommendation coming, and, you know, it'd be awkward to have a recommendation on the agenda and then have it voted down, you know, once it reaches that level. I think it'd be, you know, unfortunate for everyone.
Can I ask for a consensus this evening with respect to the two firms that we have out here as proposed firms? Without a vote. I've heard from Councilor Jordan. His opinion is loud and clear. Any other opinions that would like to be expressed this evening? Rosemary?
I support the reappointment of the former auditors. Mm-hmm. Of the current
Councilor Emerald.
I think the committee did excellent work, and I would go along with their recommendation, and I don't see any need to change auditors at this point.
Councilor Pearson.
Sounds fine to me.
Councilor McLaughlin. Okay, I would concur with my fellow councilors. Mr. Manager, if you have an item for our April agenda, clear enough?
Yes, I do. Thank you.
I'll make it unanimous.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. My apologies, Madam Chairman. My apologies. I looked this way and I just...
You were looking that way. Okay.
All right. Let us proceed, I think, to our last item on our workshop agenda. If I can find my sheet here. Yes, our last item is that I'm going to move adjournment so that we can proceed to our council agenda this evening. Hearing no debate, we are adjourned.
it's a really tough project because the council's got to approve it, the planning board's got to approve it, the zoning board's got to approve it, the school board may be interested in it, and, you know, eventually, somehow, we've got to get everyone together. And there's simply no provision for getting everyone together other than taking a turn at bat at each place and seeing how you make out. So it's in a tough position right now. So my plan is to tomorrow night inform the zoning board that this issue has come up, to try to encourage them to defer to the planning board as far as the specific site issues, and to get to them to look at the compatibility of the building in the surroundings, in that land use in that area. I hope I get away with that. In terms of it, I mean, that's a little bit direct, but I hope the zoning board is willing to defer to the planning board, recognizing that these issues are going to be fully reviewed. And, you know, I plan to be quite frank with the zoning board on this, that I would really hope they would defer to the planning board, otherwise, you know, I wouldn't be so publicly stating it this evening. But we're really in an awkward situation right now, and I did want the council to be aware of it. And, you know, hopefully I will continue to be acting as your agent in this capacity, truly representing what you want. And we'll see.
Councilor Freeman.
Well, certainly, Mr. Manager, we hope you accomplish your desire tomorrow night and leave a feeling fulfilled from your report. But what is the story here with regard to the whole issue of the legal fees being generated if we are going to open up this issue for further discussion down the road?
I don't think there'll be any more legal fees.
Okay.
But there are some additional engineering fees. Mm-hmm. There's some engineering, one of the concerns, we've already incurred some engineering fees by going with this particular layout. And I've spoken with Connie about it. And, you know, if we do go this other route, while it may cost us a little bit more in terms of engineering fees, we would save a whole lot of money in site work.
Mm-hmm.
I should have mentioned that as another advantage. Because other than, you know, creating some landscape barriers and some gate type things, you would have to work out exactly what that would be. It would be quite a bit lower cost than a lot of the site work we now have in that sort of plan. But I wouldn't expect any additional legal fees.
So you don't want any comments tonight?
Yes. If you have a comment to give him guidance for tomorrow, it's fine to do that.
Well, my comments are the layout that they have now, and I feel the cuts that they have so the buses and can get into Public Works to fuel up and get back out. And as far as the road going from one school to the other, I think you'll find some parents might be a little bit upset if they have someone in the middle school, the elementary school, they drop them off and want to get down to the high school and vice versa. And I personally can't see any big problem with that road going through there. What you're going to happen, everything that comes into the middle school is going to have to back out and go, well, I guess somebody must want a red light out the corner. That's what will generate pretty damn quick, because all that traffic's got to go over and go down the road a little ways and go back in another one. And I would almost think it makes good sense to leave that road there and let them have the cut so they can get in and out. And it might take a little education for the traffic for a little while, as far as when the kids leave the high school, to head in the right direction. And I think a little police work along that line would take care of that, and a few signs. So, and if we make it so they can line up two abreast out by the high school exit, they should be able to get out and get on the right lane, the one that's going south, the one that's going north. And it seems like the traffic pattern would be pretty damn good. And that's my feelings, that it should go with the way it is now.
Councilor Reid.
As a point of clarification, the proposal that is being presented tomorrow shows the closing of Jordan Way.
Yeah, Jordan Way would only access the public safety and public works facilities. It would not be a through road into the schools.
But the road connecting from Scott Dyer Road through to the high school would continue?
That's correct.
Thank you.
And this would have the safety gate with the emergency vehicles, is that correct?
Coming from Jordan Way into the school.
Into the school complexes, okay. That was one of our concerns. Anyone else have a comment? Council McLaughlin.
I've had some neighbors speak to me about the proposals, and they were very concerned about their potential cutting off of the through traffic between the middle school, elementary school complex and the high school. And it's been my understanding that there is bus traffic between those two school complexes on either end. And I'm not...
Right.
I'm glad all the players involved are being involved at this point. I think that's real crucial. And I think the input from the school department is going to be very valuable. And I think those people are also going to be hearing comments, if they haven't, I imagine they have already, from the parents of the school children. I've got some concerns. It's a bad night for my thinking. About cutting off the access between the two school complexes. And I want to look at the drawings and think about it. Talk to you tomorrow, probably.
Any other comments? Council Amaral.
Is there going to be some sort of a safety study done of that whole area at some point?
The problem is, we've had a traffic study done based on this plan. That's before the boards at this point. That shows that it's fine. One of the questions the planning board asked, well, why don't you redesign the parking in front of the bus garage while you're at it? And my response to that when it came up at the planning board meeting was that was a totally separate project, unrelated to this one, and you could keep mushrooming so that you're eventually over the whole school facilities. And that problem, there is a problem there, but it's existed for 15 years or whatever it is, and I really tried to dissuade the planning board from thinking that it was the public works garage expansion ought to resolve those other issues at the same time. But, safety, it goes both ways. One of the real concerns that Barbara Powers has brought up to Connie and Nancy Cotton and Nancy St. John is the fact that if people are going to the high school in the morning, they cut through there, and as people are leaving at the end of the day, even though the plan is to post the student parking lot and the other one, left turn only and right turn only to come from the back, so they go out the other way, that you still have people come up the dog bone. The dog bones the one going by the soccer field, who could come straight up through, or anyone could come in, go around the traffic circle, and still head back out. Because the plan has not been to make it one way, because they still want to get the buses back and forth. So, there are ways around, even if we post it, that people can say that, they were still observing the law. And the concern coming from there is the problem that's always been there is the traffic going straight up through. And that, from what Connie's told me, the school administrative council, the principals group, has come around to, even though maybe they weren't fully consulted a couple of years ago when it last came out, but at this point, their preference really is for the safety of the children not to have that through traffic, and they're willing to sacrifice the extra time it would take to get out of that parking area, all through all the different parking areas, in order to create a mall-type effect up at the middle school and the elementary school, and similarly to have the school self-contained, as Connie told me. In school planning, they always try to have schools self-contained instead of a through road going through schools because of trying to keep traffic that doesn't belong at that immediate school away from it. So, there's issues both ways.
Yep.
And my guess is the safety, you have a safety study done and they can practically tell you whatever it is you want to hear. Because there are arguments on both sides.
Council
Joy. It seems so they'd be a tremendous loss in traffic going through the schools once you close off Jordan Way, because on that survey there, the number of vehicles that come in there and either went one way or the other, and if you're going to, that's going to be cut off, the traffic you're going to get is going from one end to the other. So, and I wouldn't think you would have, I think it'd be a tremendous less amount of traffic. going through there?
The fear is by closing off Jordan Way, instead of going in or out Jordan Way, they're going to go right up through the elementary and the middle school.
I think it takes some education that could be done.
Councilor Reed.
I just want to comment that when the high school population is released from school, the Pond Cove Elementary and the middle school are still in session. So you're not going to, the first 20-minute rush, unless, of course, there's a schedule change. But the kids that are most anxious to get out of the school, who make that trip now today, who missed the stop sign, will be gone by the time the kids are released and the parents are showing up.
But we want to stop that traffic, and I think the school folks do, no matter what. We don't want those kids, students, who get out of the high school going up to the middle or elementary school at any time of day.
Well, if we have no additional comments or guidance to give the manager this evening, and no comments from anyone here.
So my sense, Madam Chairman, from what I did hear, is that I should proceed with the current plan until I hear differently.
Yes, Mr.
I'm
Leslie.
I'm not committed to that plan.
Yeah, that's why I'm concerned.
Mr. Leslie?
Do you want us to put that on the agenda for the April meeting and you would come before us? And
I was going to suggest it, Amy, actually, it was part of my thinking. We would have a board discussion. I don't know. I hadn't asked the manager to come.
Yeah, we're meeting the traffic engineer and the architects and Connie and whoever Connie wants to have come Thursday afternoon. She can probably relate what comes out of that meeting. My concern is that there's just so many boards to deal with, and I don't want to, you know, exclude any board, but my concern is this thing could get so complicated and so out of hand that we're not going to accomplish another objective of the planning board, and that's to get the heavy construction out of the way before school opens. And, you know, we're in a real catch-22 here.
Well, I understood that you were going to go to bat at these various...
trying.
Hence, I was saying we'll put it on the agenda.
Yeah.
We'll leave it to you and Connie to
And Connie plans to attend a planning board meeting on April, whatever. The 16th.
Some of us are already getting calls on
that. I understand that.
Quite a lot of strong feeling.
Yeah, I think that we ought to be aware of all of those feelings and the concerns as they come up before final decisions fail.
Yeah, there is one gentleman who is called a good part of the school board members, and he's expressed his concern that he's expressed to some school board members is, I think, is the through traffic. But he's also expressed to me a number of times of all the concern he has with the high school, with all that traffic getting out, and they won't be able to use Jordan Way anymore. It's every time this issue comes up, there are a ton of different opinions, and I just am very concerned that the project may have difficulty moving forward because, you know, someone's going to sit down and make a decision. And really what happens is it becomes in the hands of the planning board. Ultimately, I suppose it's going to be their decision. But then I need to come back to the council once the bids are open for funding. And, you know, you're the developer in this case in the end.
You're pretty frustrated, so So you can understand what a private developer is.
I get the planner and the code enforcement officer in my office today, you know, saying what can I do to resolve these issues, and what are going to be the board's expectations, and it's very frustrating.
Any other comments? If not, I'll take a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Thank you, one and all.
Rosemary and Tom. Yes, that's right. And the snow load was no problem.
My little notes that I have to everybody here.